start on a personal note. You know, I don't think it'll be hyperbole or exaggeration if I were to make the statement, and that is that who I am today, what I do, how I express myself, the kind of choices I've made in life, to a large extent, have been shaped by the books that I've read. So to writers, people like Twinkle and Amish, I owe an enormous debt of gratitude. I'm quite delighted, therefore, to be part of this conversation today. Thank you, people, for being here.
Thank you.
And thank you, all of you, for being here. The theme is reimagining fiction. I think the starting point should be, how is it that you guys went about reimagining what you do and who you could be? Because both of you came to writing in a completely, you know, sort of off-center, sideways route in, isn't it? So you started with acting and you started with banking, and here you are, two of India's best-selling writers. Who wants to go first?
He.
No,
she.
No, no, no. Twinkle goes first. He's ladies first.
Oh, please.
The
ladies
world
first.
Is gone of ladies
oh,
first.
Oh, for God's sake, okay. The better speaker first, okay. How about that?
Yeah, I'll take that. I think, you know, people have a concept about identity, that it is something which is rigid. Mm. But to me, in my mind, identity is fluid. It's like a snake. You keep shedding skin, except in our case, you don't see it. So as you go along, you keep evolving. Mm. And but I also feel that a lot of things which you think are linear are probably not, and it's a circle, because I was always writing. When I was very young, I used to write these awful poems about maggots, and which my mother tries to romanticize by saying, oh, no, they were lovely and they were about mangoes. Only a mother can do that. But and then I wrote half a book when I was 20, and then I didn't write anything for 20 years. And
so you sort of thought you could become a writer, wanted to become a writer, but the movies came in the way because that was the thing to do for Rajesh Khanna and Dimple Kapadia's daughter?
I didn't want to become a writer. I wanted to become a chartered accountant.
Okay.
Yeah, it sounds dreadfully dull, but that was what, you know, and I sort of was the right shape and size to become a chartered accountant, because at my 10th standard board exams, I came home and I was very excited. I said, Mom, you know, I've got 97 in maths. And she said, well, at least it matches your weight. So so I think that was a good career move for me. But yeah, the movies came along and Pink Bows took over.
Amish, how did you get to writing?
I was, I was a banker for 14 years. I come from a humble family, so we had to be pragmatic and practical in our career choices. I was always passionate about reading. I loved reading, but I never really thought I'd be a writer. In fact, most of my school and college friends who meet me, they normally ask, "Sach pata, actually kisne likha hai?" I was never creative when I was young. In fact, actually, it wasn't that I kind of chose to be a writer. It's not that I was aspiring to be a writer. There was a story idea which just grabbed my soul, and I was just writing it for myself. And by the second book, I realized that, okay, I could probably make a living from it. So when my royalty check became more than my salary, I resigned only at that time. Practical, pragmatic decision. Mm. And that's how the journey was for me. So writing, the process of writing itself, even today, is a deeply spiritual process for me. I don't care a damn about what anyone else will think. I write what feels right to me. I start thinking about what others will think only during the marketing phase.
So would you say, you know, Twinkle, you say that people have multiple identities and identities are fluid. You keep evolving, we keep evolving. You said that you kept one foot on the other side, waited till this became something that could keep you afloat. But having said that, would you say that to become writers from what you were doing and to make that step, was that the biggest act of reimagination that you had to do?
As in to become a full-time writer?
Yeah.
Look, that was a pragmatic, practical decision.
Okay, so no imagination involved?
No, yeah. I mean, it was, okay, how much money are we making? You know, can I pay the bills from this? Yeah, so it was, and is there a future one sees out there? But nothing is stopping you from writing, no matter where you are. You know, you could be a banker, you could be a journalist, you could be an actor, you could be a politician.
Yeah, or a lot of politicians in Delhi are writing poetry, isn't it?
Yeah.
Terrible poetry, if I may add.
She's much more direct. I just said, yeah. But the point is, nothing is stopping you from writing. You know, it's an expression of yourself. It's an expression of your voice. You know, and as long as you don't, you're completely detached from what others think. Because the moment you start doing that, you corrupt the flow. So just write for yourself. Let it flow.
Was it an act of imagination?
No, I don't think it was an act of imagination. Like I said, I was...
An act of reinvention for you?
No, I didn't even think about it. Like, I was very happy. I was away from the limelight. I was working in design. And one fine day, actually, my friend who was an editor from a newspaper was shifting jobs. And she came to me, and in order to revive her paper, she decided to write celebrity columns. And she said to me that, you know, you read so much and you have this weird way of looking at life and you can write a humorous column. And I remember telling her that, you know, millions of people watch cricket, doesn't mean they can play, so I don't know if I can really do this. But I did, and at that point, I felt that I had so much to say that it was relatively easy. In fact, today I'm trying to say the same things in new ways, and I find that difficult because you only have those five or six things that you want to say. Yeah. And you have to keep finding different ways of saying them. Yeah. So that was pretty much my process.
Okay. So,
no, if I may add to her columns, the reason why I like reading it, it's the way she expresses herself. So, and I think that's a rare talent, my compliments on this, that you can have something very ordinary, but the way you express it itself.
I don't want your compliments, I want your sales. Okay? I mean, really. So.
You have three books out, he has five. So, you know.
No, per book. So basically, without any sort of modesty, let me say that I'm one of the highest selling women authors. And that really bothers me. So I've kind of beaten.
Is that how you're pitched?
Yeah,
India's highest selling woman author.
Yes. Oh. I don't know, somehow my, chromosomes define my success. But. So I've kind of beaten almost everybody, but there are two people that I have not, and that's... This gentleman sitting here in the red shirt, and there's Chetan. So there are these two. And either I have to work a lot harder, or I have to somehow, give somebody a supari and assassinate them. But those are my two choices at this point.
So you're India's third best-selling author at this point of time, if you take the gender out of the equation.
Well, you can't really take the gender out of the equation because India's best-selling authors have always been two men, Valmiki and Ved Vyas. Come on, those are the best-selling books, Mahabharata, Ramayana. And so now you have today Amish and Chetan. Which one are you, Valmiki, Ved Vyas? What do you want to be? Quick.
Chetan's neither Valmiki or Ved Vyas. He writes modern stuff. I write the mythological stuff.
So the fact that you're a woman gets in the way still? I mean, you would imagine that in writing, it wouldn't matter to people whether you were female or male.
I don't think that is gender comes between you and your readers. I think he's also got a large body of work, and Chetan also has a large body of work, and maybe I'll get there. Being a woman comes in different ways when you're writing, but not in sales. I would say, yeah, there's different approach to writing, and there are different forms of writing. But not in sales. No.
So it doesn't matter to the reader.
No,
the
I don't
publisher
think it
may be publishers and the publishing industry may be pitching you like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, so, I don't read her as a woman. I read her as a as someone who I like to read. That's all. As a good author.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. I don't think being a woman comes in terms of sales. Yeah. It comes in terms of different things. For example. True. I read an interview of yours that you get up really early at 6, and I get up at 6 as well. And then you do your puja for an hour. Then you read 4 newspapers.
No, not an hour, around half an hour.
Half an hour. Then you read 4 newspapers. Then you go into your study, and you put on some music, and you eat cream biscuits.
Amish is very flattered at the moment, too.
Okay, I'm a little scared now.
So when I read that, I actually turned to my husband and I said,
You have all this information, and you want to take out a supari on me also.
So when I read all this, I turned to my husband and I said, I really want what he has. And he said, what, cream biscuits? And I said, no, wife, because there's obviously some woman running around there with toothpaste in her hair, getting the kids to school while he's reading the paper. So I think that is the only difference between a male and a female
professional
author.
Of any kind, author or otherwise, right? A wife. The idea of a wife.
We all need a wife.
Yeah. Yeah, I must tell you, I had a conversation with Jaya Bachchan once a long time ago when she brought out this book on Amitabh Bachchan, commemorating his 60th year. And I said, so, but Jayaji, you have a huge body of work. You're one of India's finest actors. Why don't we have a book on you? Maybe when you turn 60, do we see Amitabh Bachchan doing that? She just looked at me and she said, for that, my dear, you need a wife. So I think, I get where that's coming from. And I think a lot of people would agree. What is interesting is that we're talking about reimagining fiction. And I'm a little dogged like that. That's the theme. And I keep trying to go back to it. So when you say reimagining fiction, would you say humor and this sort of looking at really some of the deepest things that we are grappling with in our times in today? And sort of giving it this really light touch. So you're sort of saying weighty things, but there is something that you manage to make us smile as we get to the point you're trying to make. Is that something that is hard work and design when you talk about bringing humor to writing and fiction?
It depends on your personality. To me, humor is nothing but the intrinsic truth seen through a peculiarly slanted magnifying glass. So. There is nothing that is funny which is not true. If I make a joke, and that's what my bio says, that why do all Hindu boys worship their mother? Because their religion tells them to worship the cow. You laugh because that is true. But if I made a joke in a different way and said, why do all Hindu boys worship their father? Because their religion tells them to worship the buffalo. Nobody would laugh because it's not true. And they don't worship their father anyway. So it's basically... So it's basically what is true, and you just look at it in a different way, and like he said, in a pragmatic way.
And this is something that's instinctive. It comes naturally because there's craft involved, okay? There is some amount of writing, rewriting, drafting. Is it landing? Does the joke hit home? How does that work? Give us a little bit of a sense of how that works for you.
So my deadline is Friday afternoon, and I start writing on Monday, because what happens is that I like to have three jokes, that's my format, in a column, and the jokes don't come on that one day, so it could happen when you're walking, normally happens, for some reason it happens when you're in the shower, and then you have those jokes. So yeah, you have to make sure that, at least I have to make sure I have three jokes, and the rest of the column comes together quite easily. It's those three that you wait for.
Amish, we've talked often about your books, and you've made it very clear that there is this whole, you're reimagining the epics, you're reimagining the narrative of the epics, and you're sort of contemporizing them, putting in issues there, and you're sort of, in a way, even reintroducing all of us to Vedic
exactly.
wisdom.
Yes.
Yeah. How did you come by this? Because so far, that's what you've done in all the books you've written.
I think that's too high a compliment. Who am I to reintroduce Vedic wisdom? And it's a part of our bones. It's a part of our genes. We've grown up with it. But I think that perhaps much of the deeper understanding of that knowledge has been lost over the last few centuries, and certainly in the last 70 years because of our education system. It's still a very colonial education system.
Yeah.
And the more educated we are, the less Indian we become. And one of the things I feel very strongly, and it's, I've learned a lot from my family. My grandfather was a Pandit in Banaras.
Right.
And I genuinely believe that there is a wonderful liberal wisdom in our ancient scriptures. And we can, it's one of the things I've said publicly very often, that one of the misfortunes of India is many of the liberals in India have not realized that our ancient culture is actually their biggest ally. But they haven't read any of it, so they have no clue. And if you're able to fight for the rights of LGBTs, for the rights of women, by quoting our own gods, our own goddesses, our own scriptures, the chances of you finding success are that much higher, rather than quoting some Westerner.
Right.
You know, I'd said this at an event. I don't do too many events, but I'd said this at an event somewhere. This was pre Section 377 being repealed, and I'd quoted this wonderful line: "Purush napunsak nari va jeeva charachar koi sarva bhava bhaja kapata taji mohi param priya soi." that any man, any woman, any transgender, any living being, any plant, any animal, if you give up deceit and you come to me, you are all my people. Guess who said this? It's a wonderful line, right?
Yeah.
In tune with the liberal ideology today. Guess who said this line? Any guesses?
Any guesses?
Guess who said this wonderful line? Guess who said this line? No, it's not him. Lord Ram. Mm. Lord Ram said this. Mm. And he specifically says any transgender. Mm. Now imagine if you fight for transgender rights by quoting Lord Ram. Mm. Imagine the impact you have.
Yeah.
And the problem is that many of us Indians are simply unaware of our culture, of our scriptures. There is a wide array. You know, we have... sorry, I'm taking a bit of time on this. I feel very passionately about this. But, you know, the pre-printing press manuscripts, the number of manuscripts that are available in the world, the mother culture of European culture is essentially the Greek culture, right? There are between 20 to 30,000 pre-printing press manuscripts that are available today. Printing press was what, 15th century? Yeah. Gutenberg, the Gutenberg press.
Yeah.
Guess how many pre-printing press manuscripts of Sanskrit are available today? This, despite the destruction of the Nalanda University and the Ujjain University, which are, in my mind, and the Takshashila University, which are the biggest disasters in India in the last 1,000 years.
Right.
Despite that, there are at least 3 million Sanskrit manuscripts that survive till today. That is the extent of knowledge production that our ancestors did.
Right.
And it's not just stories, it's scientific.
They've survived, but they may not be well preserved.
They haven't even been translated, man.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
we're a bunch of morons. We are inheritors of among the greatest bodies of wisdom and knowledge that any culture can be blessed with.
Yeah.
And we idiots don't even want to, forget about studying them, we don't even want to translate them, we don't even want to acknowledge them. And there's so much beautiful wisdom in there.
There's some work has begun in that, you know, the Murthy,
the National Manuscript
Classic Foundation.
That's some 300 books. It's a drop. It's a good
Patanjali.
It's a step. But
Patanjali,
the National Manuscript Mission has started some work on this. I keep saying this, that we need to explore our past and we can fight for liberal causes much more strongly if we read our own scriptures.
Twinkle is, so the point Amish makes is well made and well taken, and you know, and yet we also know that in this attempt to rediscover the past, we are interpreting the past in different ways and in ways which suit us. When it, you know, it suits me to say transgender is, you know, Shikhandi is transgender and Ram is said transgenders are welcome, and it suits people to say that we did our first plastic surgery here and look at Ganesh.
Yeah.
So how do you react to this kind of need to rediscover and reacquaint? But also this revisioning and repurposing that's happening based on, you know, individual agendas.
So while growing up, I was a science fiction reader. My whole life I've read Asimov and Philip K. Dick. And so for me, I was always dreaming about the future. The past wasn't as important. And in fact, everything that they wrote in the 70s is what's happening today in our times. I feel that we are a very peculiar country. We seem to have one foot very firmly in the past and one in the future. So we are sending, you know, a space mission to Mars, but we're also looking at the moon and fasting, right? We have nuclear power, but we're tying black threads around our wrists and, you know, sort of making that into a force field. So we haven't really been able to amalgamate, he's right, the wisdom of what we have in the future, but of the past, but we are also not making progress, as much progress towards the future as we should be. Now what's happening is I feel that the narrative is becoming not about wisdom, but about, I would say, Hinduism and Hindutva, rather, which I find sort of alarming.
You want to say more?
No.
Okay. Let's talk about, you know, when you talk about reimagining anything, what's happening now is that we're reimagining the gender equation, isn't it? In a big way, everywhere. Whether, Amish, you wrote the second book in your Ramchandra series was Sita, the warrior princess, right? You reimagined Sita for us. Twinkle, your latest book, Pajamas...
Forgiving.
Pajamas are forgiving. Pajamas are forgiving. Again, you do very in a very nuanced manner explore this gender the gender equation, right? And also how we understand it and deal with it. My question is it time to write more about what's happening right now? Because women, what we feel, what we think, what we want, our rights, our boundaries, what you can do with us, what you think your entitlements are vis-a-vis women, all that is so front and center today, isn't it? Is it time for writers, because you are the people who give us ideas and you process the zeitgeist, you ask the big questions, is it time to reimagine how women are talked about and the way stories of women are told?
I think he should answer that, and then I'll
keep
my bit. Yeah, okay. Please go ahead.
Do you want to go first?
No, no, you go ahead.
Okay. No, yeah, I strongly believe in that. I mean, I think one of the approaches of all ancient pagan cultures, that any story, any book without some philosophy at its core is like a body without a soul. It's pointless. Mm. So there has to be some philosophy, some thoughts that the author wants to convey.
So to see that?
Whether the reader agrees with it or not is their choice. Now, in my mind, yes, this is one of the biggest issues confronting us today, the way women are treated. Even our ancient scriptures say the gods abandon the land where women are not respected. And I agree with her that just those who just keep, you know, talking about the past with pride but not looking at the future are being, that's a waste of time, right? You should use the past to power the future. Just getting lost in the past is pointless. That doesn't help, right? And yes, I feel very strongly about this issue.
Which issue? That
about how women are treated in our society. And if we want to become the country that we are capable of, then this is a societal problem. I don't think it's going to get solved in, you know, with one book or in 5 years or in 10 years. It's a generational fight, right? But it's something everyone has to contribute to. It's one of the things I try to do with Sita Warrior of Mithila. The impression that we have of Lady Sita in our mind has been built largely on a 1980s television serial. And the 1980s television serial had quite a few significant differences from the original Valmiki Ramayana. Mm. For example, I'm sure most people out here would believe perhaps that Lakshman Rekha is there in the Ramayana because they would have seen it in the 80s television serial.
Yeah.
But Lakshman Rekha is not mentioned in the original Valmiki Ramayana, right? There is an ancient version of the Ramayana called the Adbhut Ramayana, where Sita Ma killed Ravan. Not Lord Ram, Sita Ma killed the main Ravan, the elder Ravan, right? I am trying to, you know, maybe in my own small way through my books, present that. So in Mithila, for example, the Prime Minister is Lady Sita's mother,
right.
Queen Sunena.
Right.
You know, so women are in positions of authority.
Okay.
They make decisions, they make choices. Doesn't mean that they have to, you know, behave like a proto man or something. They have their own agency and they behave the way they do.
Let me get Twinkle in here. So, Twinkle, I think you're writing, but it's not, I don't think you mean it to be gendered.
Add to his. Mm-hmm. Again, my problem with mythology and our sacred writings is that there's no woman writing it.
Mm.
So, it's a male narrative. Mm. Are there any women who are writing all these scriptures?
The Vedas, for example, there are hymns in the Vedas written by Rishikas, women rishis. It's like the equivalent of having women prophets, women messiahs.
So that's fantastic.
So Maharishika Lopamudra, Maharishika Indrani, Maharishika Maitreyi. The Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is essentially a conversation between Maharishika Maitreyi and Maharishi Yajnavalkya.
So that's actually reassuring. Absolutely reassuring.
Yeah.
At this point of time, what I would like to say is that, yes, the way that women, the position in women, it's not even how they're portrayed, and the sort of chafing between what a woman is and what she's meant to be is something that we do have to explore. And we also have...
Are you conscious about the fact that in your writing that you are giving women a voice, even though it's not by design gendered? It's not like I'm a woman and I'm going to talk about other women.
No, sometimes it is by design. And I feel that there are two sorts of feminists that I feel. One is, you can say I've had the privilege of living life on my own terms, and so now people can look at my life as an inspiration.
Hmm.
The other is, you can say that I've had the privilege of living life on my own terms, but now I'm going to do something to alleviate the condition of other women around me, and I would hopefully be the latter.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, I came across Murganantham's story
about
the sanitary pad, And we decided that, you know, I wrote that, and then I realized that the story really needs to cut across many other boundaries, and of caste and culture and economic structures. So we decided to make Padman. And I think a few months after Padman was released, suddenly we saw the government, you know, talking about low-cost sanitary pads. Mm. We saw sanitary pad dispensing machines in railway stations. The GST was waived off. Yeah. And somewhere I think that the little bit that we did definitely contributed towards that change, and it has made life easier for a lot of women, and a lot of women who've seen the movie and who've, you know, spoken to their, and all those myths that, oh, you can't go into the, you know, the temple, or you can't go into the kitchen, it's just become a little bit easier for women.
So Twinkle, we are talking smack bang in the in the middle of this whole Tanushree Dutta, the actor, raising allegations against Nana Patekar and other people, about just sexual assault, you know, and crossing the line, and using a professional relationship for everything else but that. We are also talking about, or noticing and commenting on, how the film industry, which she belongs to and Nana Patekar belongs to, is really actually a bit, you know, arm's length distance. See no evil, hear no evil, definitely speak no evil. Do you feel that the film industry, and I do understand that this is true across industries and across professions, but given the iconic status of the film industry, do you think the onus is more on this industry to speak up, to confront people? Will there be a Bill Cosby outed soon in India? I really wonder sometimes.
So I have a problem with this whole thing of an industry. You can't look at anything as an industry. You have to look at it as individual people. Are there people who are willing to speak up? There are some. Are there some who are not willing to speak up? That's fair enough. So that's across the board.
Right.
I don't think that just because they're in the limelight, every finger has to be pointed. It's happening everywhere. In fact, I think it started probably in India in publishing and academics first.
Yeah.
So there's definitely, what I feel is that what has been happening all these years, where there was oppression on one side, was completely an unnatural situation. Yeah. The pendulum will swing right to the other side before it comes into equilibrium. So there will be collateral damage, and there should be. But all of this sort of filth will get eradicated.
But do you think, so I get it. I don't think that, but I think given the kind of hold the movies have on our imagination, so if a Padman manages to make me rethink and reassess how I deal with menstruation and how society's attitudes are towards menstruation, similarly, if in the real world of the film industry, not in the movies they make, but in the actual life process of the film industry, if women stand up and say, you know, X did this and Y did that, and more of that happens, like we've seen in Hollywood. We saw Me Too, and most critically, we saw Time's Up, right? Do you see, given your proximity to the business, right, and this is a proximity over that you've inherited, do you see the film industry ready for a successful Me Too leading up to a Time's Up, which is about accountability, which is about Weinstein, with a tag around his ankle, which is about Bill Cosby looking at a few years in jail? Is the film industry ready to do that? And I'm making no apologies for the fact that it is getting the short end of the stick, but that's the status of the industry, of the business.
Again, I'm not a representative. I felt strongly about it. I spoke up.
Yeah.
I, you know, threw my voice in with other people. And that's about all each person can do.
Right.
I can't really talk about all of them. There's, you know, it's a large industry. I can only do what I can do. Again, there are lots of times when people come and ask me, what about the industry? Or your political views are different from your husband's. Or there is only one person I'm responsible for. My words, my actions. I'm the only person I'm bringing to this table is me.
Sure.
This is not a McDonald's happy meal that you get a hamburger and french fries with it. There's just a hamburger, that's me. You want it, eat it. You want the french fries, sign up for that.
And what did you say about Tanushree Dutta?
I said, I tweeted about her in support of her, that this sort of thing should, harassment in any sort of work situations should be eradicated.
Mm. Okay.
And we should all stand up for it. And I thought she was very brave, and she's paving the way for all of us.
Okay. Amish, film industry, the movie business, always in the spotlight. But would you agree if I say that if something happens there to shake up the status quo when it comes to how women are dealt with or how women deal with people in the industry, it will have a far greater ripple and cascading effect across this country?
No, I think...
don't be careful now. Come on, just say what you're thinking.
Okay. One is at an individual level, when individuals are seeing, we really need to get our justice system moving so that if someone is accused, things are investigated and closed quickly. Because if too many perpetrators get away, then other perpetrators think they can get away too.
Right.
That's one part. The second part, I would think anyone, any industry which is in the public space, which is impacting public opinion, it could be movies, it could be books, it could be the media, all of us have to be responsible. This is one of the things I've spoken of publicly, that in many ways Bollywood movies have normalized stalking, right? That ladki ki naam mein haan hai, you know, or hasi to phasi. No, these things are not okay.
Yeah.
You know, and it is the way things are portrayed in the media as well, the way things are portrayed in the books as well. Anyone who's in this industry has to be responsible for the messages that you're putting out. And that is something that I think everyone in that industry can take charge for. See, an individual, and to be fair, and you can't hold her responsible
for what
individuals may have done.
Yeah.
Yeah, but what you can hold anyone in the media industry, anyone who's in the public communication industry responsible for, is what messages are they putting out?
I
mentioned Bollywood normalizing stalking. That's not okay, man.
Yeah.
And Bollywood has done it for decades.
Yeah. Twinkle, sorry, it'll sound like I'm sort of going for you. I'm not really. But the point is that you remember in the middle there was this whole controversy, brouhaha on Twitter about Akshay saying something about Mallika Dua, the comedian. You say something as a protective partner and then you have to take it back because then you wear the hat of being a woman. Is that fair to say?
No, I think what happens I like to look at life with a little bit of a distance and a perspective. And sometimes, and luckily for me, it's very rare that sometimes my emotions get kind of twisted into that. And I feel that at that time I lose perspective. And so I guess I did at that point. That's it. So you step back and you re-examine and you learn and you move on.
It's interesting, her latest book, Pajamas Are Forgiving, there is a little, you know, there is, you do sort of, you show as a woman protagonist actually reassessing the situation around her and looking at it from two completely different ways, isn't it? This your character Anshu and what happens to the another character called Jenna. Read it because I think it's quite interesting. It's very nuanced and this conversation is not black and white as you've written in the book. The clock is counting down. I've got lots of questions beginning with Nikhil Khanna who wants to know, are you the new Shobhade? It's just going to make it so much easier if you know that.
Well, am I going to be a legend at 70? Yes, I probably am. So if that's your definition, I'll go by that.
Yeah. Okay. Rahul Kishore. Rahul Kishore says, Twinkle, get back into movies. You're still better than the current crop.
Never. I don't think I had the talent for that, as you can see in many of my movies, and I'm very happy sort of being out of the spotlight.
Okay.
Can somebody ask Amish something?
I'm sorry, but clearly you're getting more attention.
You're the star.
I wonder why.
Yeah, right.
How can you... a lady called Ritu Kanodia wants to know, how can you monitor something... Tell tips for fitness and beauty. Not eating. I don't know. How can you monitor something? Sorry, dash. Tell tips for fitness and beauty.
Maintain.
Oh, monitor. No, sorry, maintain. Sorry. Thank you, Rini. How can you maintain? I'm still not getting it. But you know the you.
Yes,
you're getting
the gist. I got the question. What I'd like to say is that you have to, you know, a lot of people say, oh, you have to be really comfortable in your skin and enjoy the body you have now. And to me, the only way that makes sense is that I would say if you were, I spoke to my grandmother and it came back to this, that when you're 75 years old, you'll be willing to give half your failing right kidney to have the body you have now. So enjoy it, you know, whatever shape and size it is.
Okay, Rini, sorry, I can't read this. Will you read it in your lovely voice?
Why is no one asking you to use this mic?
As a woman author,
I don't want to answer this.
As a woman author, have you faced a pejorative attitude that judges you as a loose moral person if your writing is candid and graphic with regards to sexual descriptions?
No, but I did read something about another woman author who said, you know, when people write murder mysteries, nobody wonders if you're going around murdering your neighbors, but if you write about sex, and that's the kind of sex you're supposed to be having.
Okay, this is the last question we have, and it's for...
Is it for Amish?
No.
So we won't read this till there's a question for Amish. Come on.
Yeah,
one thing about Amish must pique your curiosity.
No, Twinkle has to answer. We've got only a minute left, so go ahead, ask her.
No question for Amish. Twinkle, you go ahead, ask him a question.
Oh, for God's sake.
When you are reading these four papers and eating your cream biscuits, who's buying the cream biscuits for you?
I have an Amazon app, and am I allowed to take commercial names out here, or does that get banned or something? No, I just order on the Amazon app. And what tends to happen very often, it's an interesting thing, whenever I go to LitFest, there are many readers of mine who actually come with packets of cream biscuits.
So that's how you're collecting these cream biscuits.
Ye lo aur jaldi likho.
Okay. The last question is from a lady called Priya to Twinkle. Can we expect a book on your days in Ashirwad Bungalow and also about Kaka Rajesh Khanna?
Again, like I said, some things are too close to have a perspective, and I think my family would be one of them. It's, you know, some things are sacred, and some things you really can't step back enough to examine. All relationships, I feel, where love is involved, even if it's with your children, are based on delusions. You know, delusions are those, that's garnish that you put on all the sort of unappetizing bits. So how do you really write about that if you see everything through delusion? So I think as far as my family is concerned, I'll step back.
Well put.
All right. Twinkle, Amish.
Well put.
Well put. Thank you very much. It was a wonderful conversation. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.